that we feel in this place. Thank you for the presence of the Holy Spirit. We don't take it for granted because we know your Spirit does not tarry everywhere. We thank you that we've not grieved you this morning, that you decided to stick around a little bit. And for that, we're grateful. We praise you. We thank you. We thank you, Father, for sending your word and healing us. We declare that upon the entrance of your word, there is light.
Yes.
Light floods our heart.
Yes.
Light floods this atmosphere.
Yes.
Light floods even the neighborhoods surrounding this school, this community. Light, send your light. Can you just shout that out? Send your light, Lord. Send your light. Send your light, Lord. Flood this earth. Upon the entrance of your word, there is light.
Yes, it is. Thank
you. In Jesus' name, we thank you.
Yes,
hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, send your word out and let it accomplish all that you set forth for it to accomplish in Jesus' name. Speak to the hearts, men and women, boys and girls. Let us have ears to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to the church. We thank you now. And we receive in advance. We thank you in advance. Can you help me do that just by putting your hands together and just thank God in advance for this word? Come on. If you bless God in advance, your expectation reaches the atmosphere for miracles. Hallelujah! Help me give it up for Minister Neil Jones and our sisters. Hallelujah. Thank you. Well, thank you for being here at the Restoration Place. You may be seated. You see, I don't know how many of you were here last week, but my wife and I, we came out with our boxing gloves on. I mean, we literally had them on. And Maurice, we were boxing, man. We were throwing down. Yeah. See, you leave town one week, we're going to fight each other. We kind of had a face-off. You know, we were standing forehead to forehead like that. We just had a face-off, and, Michael, what's my man's name? Buffer. Michael Buffer was in the house last week. I forgot to tell y'all that we flew him in especially just to conduct our fight. And the whole point was, with that being Super Bowl Sunday, is that there were two opponents that were going to be competing against each other, right? And one was going to leave the field a winner, and the other one was going to leave the field a loser, right? Somebody won, somebody lost, right? Now, the right team didn't win, right? Those of you Carolina fans.
That's right.
Yeah, we would have loved for our Carolina Panthers to have won, but they didn't. But somebody had to win. Somebody had to lose. But what we're telling you is that you're on the same team.
That's right. Amen.
In your relationships.
Yeah.
We're all on the same team. And so that's why our theme this month is relationship. As we make life shifts throughout 2016. Remember, we started off with life shifts. As we make life shifts, shift our life to the next level. We're telling you that what's going to help shift your life to the next level is your relationships. Your relationships, how we interact in our relationships with one another is going to impact how God is able to shift your life from one place to the next. How many of you want to have a life shift this year? Yeah. Well, then you're going to have a relationship. Say that with me. Relationship.
Relationship.
Yeah, that means God's going to have to impact our relationships this year for the positive. Yes. And I don't care if it's with your family. I don't care if it's with your spiritual family, your biological family, or with people, your co-workers, whomever they are. We all can be better in our relationships.
Amen.
How many of you would agree with that?
Yes.
Yeah, definitely. So we don't have the gloves on today. Y'all, you know, don't worry, we're not going to give each other black eyes today. We don't have the gloves on. And this is communicating to you, our audience, and those that are watching via Periscope, is we are communicating to you that it's time to take the gloves off. It's time to take the gloves off. Put them on your shoulder, hang them up, put them off somewhere. You're not going to need them anymore. Put them down. On your way home, tell your wife, hey, I took the gloves off. You know, y'all may have had just a little, you know, whatever this morning, a little spat. Maybe not. Maybe you did. But it's time for both parties to take your gloves off, because in this dynamic, in a relationship, we are all on the same team. Say, we're all on the same team.
We're all on the same team.
And in a relationship, there has to be a win-win. Has to be win-win. Both parties has to come out on top, or else that relationship is going to be in trouble. It's going to be in jeopardy. Whenever a party in a relationship feels like they're losing, then that relationship is in jeopardy. All right? Say, it must be a win-win. And so, if you just kind of, you can go ahead and turn our lights on. Someone over there close to that spot, Miss Anai or John, turn our, you can just turn one row on, I believe, like we did last week. And sweetheart, why don't you go ahead and just get us, well, you know what? I think I'm actually getting us started here. I want you to turn to Amos 3:3. Amos chapter 3, verse 3. Amos chapter 3, verse 3. All right. Amos chapter 3, verse 3 says this in the Amplified. Now, I'll give you a little bit more time to find it. Amos chapter 3, verse 3. It says this in the New Living Translation. Can two people walk together without agreeing on the direction? Can two people walk together without agreeing on the direction? I want to also read this out of the Amplified Translation. If I can, let me read this out of the Amplified Translation, Amos chapter 3, verse 3. Of course, when you're dealing with technology, you are challenged.
It says,
do you have it, sweetheart?
Yes, can please. Two people walk together unless they first make an appointment?
Oh, unless they first make an appointment. I almost feel like my childhood pastor. He used to have somebody read and then he'd teach behind him. y'all remember that? Read! yes. Do two walk together except they make an appointment and have agreed? So we have a couple of things going on here. We have one translation in the New Living Translation says that can two people walk together without agreeing on the direction? Then the Amplified Translation is translating this scripture in that two can only walk together unless they make an appointment and have agreed on, if I can say it this way, where to meet. Where to meet. When you make an appointment with someone, you're not just making an appointment with time, you're making an appointment with place, right? So when I make an appointment with you, says I'm going to meet you when I send you a outreach calendar invite. I am sending you a calendar invite on this is the time that we're going to meet and this is where we're going to meet. Now, so say I call Maurice up and I say, Maurice, let's go jogging in the morning. And so what's the first thing Maurice gonna ask?
Where?
Where? Where you wanna go jog? And then we say, well, I tell you what, meet me at such and such corner of such and such, and we're gonna park our cars there and we're gonna jog down this little trail that I know about. And then of course, if we haven't established a time, we're gonna make an appointment around a common time, right? So we established a place. Say a place.
A place.
All right. So when we meet up, it's the next morning. We got our jogging gear on. Me and Maurice, we ready to go. Man, we high-fiving each other. We ready. And so here we go. But then before we can get started, now we got to determine what? Where? Which direction? Say which direction.
Which direction?
So we're gonna make a determinant on the place. Then once we meet up in that place, now we have to determine a direction. So these are the two things that are going on as it relates to agreement. It says, how can two walk together unless they first come to a agreed upon place? Say place. And then it says, another translation says, how can two walk together, or how can they be in agreement unless they make an appointment, or unless they determine the direction? So you need an agreed upon place and you need an agreed upon direction in order to walk in agreement. Amen?
Amen.
To
walk together.
Or to walk together. So
he didn't say our topic today. Our topic today is
getting to agreement.
I said when we ended last week that we would come back this today and talk about how to agree when you don't agree. How to get to agreement when you don't agree.
And that really raised some eyebrows.
Yeah, several people who are not here today are really concerned that they're not getting this topic, because I know that's a real thing. Especially if you've been in church for any measure of time, and then we hear about the power of agreement and coming into agreement and the powerful things that happen when people get into agreement. But how do you do that? How do you get there? It's a place. How do you get to agreement, especially when you don't agree?
You just said something, Pastor Nett, that's a real thing. It is a real thing. You know why it's so real? And it's somewhat of a crisis in relationships, because people are so uniquely different. God created us unique. You're unique. I, in my own way, I'm unique. And that's good. We need to celebrate uniqueness. We need to celebrate differences. I don't think we do a good enough job in our society celebrating differences. We need to celebrate people's uniqueness. Everybody doesn't have to be cookie cutter. Everybody doesn't have to be the same, like robots. That means we would have a robotic society. So we celebrate differences. So you're different, I'm different. As my wife's dad used to say, bless his heart, he said, you got your habits, I got my habits. What he was saying was habits. You know, you got your habits, I got my habits.
Habages is plural for habits.
Habages.
Habages.
And so what I'm telling you is that you got your habages, I got my habages. You have your differences, I have my differences. We celebrate those differences, but we get stuck on differences. We get hung up on differences. We can't get past the differences. And so how do you agree when you disagree? Somebody said that's a real deal. That is a real deal. And so we're going to talk about getting to agreement. Let's go to Psalm 133. And we're just going to read a few of the following scriptures. Yeah, I actually have it. It says, how wonderful and pleasant, I'm reading out of the New Living Translation. How wonderful and pleasant it is when brothers live together in harmony. There's another translation, I believe, in the King James translation. It says, how wonderful and pleasant it is when brothers come together in unity, harmony, or agreement. For harmony or agreement is as precious as the anointing oil that was poured over Aaron's head, that ran down his beard and onto the border of his robe. Harmony or agreement or unity is as refreshing as the dew from Mount Hermon. So agreement is refreshing. Have you ever been in a environment or in an atmosphere where there's disagreement?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It's not refreshing, then, is it? The first thing you want to do is find the exit. It's like, what's the quickest way out of here? Something's not going on right here. But it's refreshing when you have agreement. Now listen, unity does not mean uniformity. Unity does not mean uniformity. Can you say that with me? Unity does not mean uniformity. Now that's important to remember. Because just because we walk in unity or we walk in agreement does not mean everybody got to have a red sweater on this morning. That's uniformity. Okay? You know, at my daughter's school, it's one of those schools where they have uniforms. Everybody's uniform. They're walking in uniformity. All right? Well, this is not one of those situations. Just for us to be in agreement does not mean we got to wear the same shoes.
That's right.
Does not mean we got to get our hair cut the same. Boy, that would make for a boring society, wouldn't it? That everybody gotta dress alike. We gotta get our hair fixed alike and all of this. I love differences. I love different colors. I love wild colors. I love bland colors. I love all types of differences. Tall people, short people. I just love it all, man. Don't y'all like the differences that you see? It would make for a boring world if we didn't have the differences. And see, here's one thing that you got to remember. Don't ever let this leave you, that unity and uniformity are not the same. We do not have to be uniform to walk in unity. All right? So it says how sweet and pleasant it is. Agreement, if you're taking notes, produces a good and pleasant atmosphere. Agreement, if you're taking notes, produces a good and pleasant atmosphere in which to dwell. Agreement. It produces a good atmosphere. You want a good atmosphere in your home? Seek agreement.
Amen. Amen.
Seek to get an agreement. Don't be stubborn.
Yeah.
Don't you stay on your point.
Come on, man.
It's my point.
Yeah.
I own this point.
Yeah.
I'm not moving from this place. Do you know you will never reach agreement that way?
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
And the atmosphere in your relationship, if I can say it this way, my wife don't like this word for me to say it, but it's going to be jacked up.
All right, then.
It's going to be jacked up.
It's going to be jacked up.
And there are some jacked up relationships in this world.
Come on, man.
I believe we need to work on our relationships. How about you?
Amen.
Agreement produces oil, the Bible says. It says it's like the oil that flows down Mount Hermon. It produces oil or an anointing. The oil represents anointing in the Word of God. It produces an anointing or power. When we talk about anointing, we're talking about power to get something done.
Yeah.
When you are anointed for something, God has given you the power. It's a God-enabled power to get something done that you could not get done in your flesh.
Amen. That's
right. So when we walk in agreement is it anoints us to do something together that we could not do in our flesh. So agreement is really supernatural. It really is. It's hard to love somebody that don't see eye to eye with you. Because in our flesh, I want you to see eye to eye with me.
That's right. That's right.
Right? So it takes the love of God, not the love of man.
Love of God.
Right.
It takes the love of God to walk in agreement.
Yes, it does.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes.
Y'all, you can't use your love and walk in agreement.
Come on.
See, I believe that that's half the challenge is that we're trying to use man phileo love instead of agape love.
Amen.
And so agreement produces oil or an anointing that is powerful for progress. Can you say that? Powerful for progress.
Powerful for progress.
You know, I noticed my wife and I, whenever we want to make progress, we gotta be in agreement.
We must be in agreement.
And when we're in agreement, we make great progress. My wife and I, we came into agreement a couple of years ago that we were going to get out of debt. Uh-huh. Now, I'm ashamed to say that we are still trying to get out of debt. We had gotten out of debt, the debt that we had created at that time, but then we didn't stay disciplined, and we created some more debt. But we are in agreement that now we are going to get out of debt, and then stay in agreement that we're going to be disciplined enough to stay out of debt.
Amen.
And that deserves everybody's hand clap right now. That should be everybody's goal. Not just married couples, but singles, everybody. Alright, so man, we can do powerful things together, not just husbands and wives. But you, anybody you're in relationship with, your business partner, anybody, your family member, anybody you're in relationship with, that you have a relationship with, you can do powerful things, man, when you come into agreement.
Come into agreement.
And so my wife, she's going to talk a little bit more about Matthew chapter 18, verse 19.
Okay, Matthew 18 and 19. Matthew 18 and 19, if you could pull that up. These are the words of Jesus. He said this, "Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven." Now that's powerful right there.
That's right. Guys,
as a woman who is alive because of the power of prayer, I understand how powerful that statement is right there. "Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven." That's the New King James Version. I think it's the Message Bible. Yes, the Message Bible says it this way, which when I read this, it painted a picture in my mind that I want to help create in your mind. The Message Bible says this way, "When two of you get together on anything at all on earth and make a prayer of it."
That's good. Wow.
"My Father in
make
heaven
a prayer
comes
of it.
Into action."
Yes.
Wow.
So there's some key phrases here that I want to focus in this scripture. It says, Jesus said, if two of you get together. Now, why come just only one? Could you say if you ask anything on earth? But this one says, if two of you, two of you. And so that means relationship.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That means relationship.
That's right.
Jesus is saying two people coming together who probably are different, who probably have different opinions about the matter, different desires about the matter. Mm-hmm. But if two people come together on a matter and get to an agreement concerning that matter.
Right.
Then he says, and then you make a prayer right there.
That's good.
That's where God is.
That's where God is.
And so the power of it is not what you pray. The power of it is not even what you agree upon. The power is the process that it takes to come to agreement.
Yes.
That's good.
Yes.
And we're going to see it really takes this big four-letter word called love.
Power is in the process.
The power is the process to get to agreement.
Yes.
Agreement, we're going to show you today that agreement is a place that you come to. It is the place of love, it's the place of peace, it's the place of unity. And this is where God and all of his miraculous power is, in the place of agreement. Mm-hmm. So today we're going to talk to you about the process of getting to that place. Even when you don't agree with the other person, the other party or parties, whoever is involved, if you follow this process, you can still get to agreement.
Right.
You're going to have to be willing to humble yourself and yield. Okay? So that's what we're going to talk to you about, is the process of getting to agreement. Now that you see how powerful agreement is, and the anointing that is produced, and the power and the progress that you can experience, if you can get to this wonderful place called agreement, hopefully we'll be able to do a good job today of teaching you how to get there.
Yes. Yes. So we said again, because I don't want you to lose sight on this, that agreement is a place that you come to. It is the place that you come to. And my wife and I, we have this table sitting here, and I don't want to get ahead of myself, but she eventually is going to talk a little bit about this place that we come to. Agreement is a place. Can you say that? Agreement is a place.
Agreement is a place.
Say that once again. Agreement is a place.
Agreement is a place.
Now I want to talk a little bit about why disagreement is destructive in relationships. How many of you would agree that disagreement is destructive?
Amen.
Well, that's the first place that we got to get to. You got to acknowledge that disagreement is destructive. This is not good for me. This is not good for me. Just like I had to acknowledge that eating ice cream at 10:30 at night was not good for me. Every night. Ain't nobody saying that, y'all. just ball your toes up if I'm stepping on your feet. But no, I was eating a big bowl of ice cream every night. My wife can tell you, bar none. Every night. as they say in the country, every night God sent, I was eating me a bowl of ice cream. And I was sitting there on the couch one night just enjoying my ice cream, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me out of the blue and said, you're going to kill yourself if you keep doing that.
All right, now.
I said, that's a novel idea. I'm going to kill myself if I keep eating this ice cream every night. Notice I'm saying every night I was eating ice cream. Maybe not once a week, but I was doing it every night. I mean, it was my date. It was my date with my ice cream at 10:30 p.m. Me and the TV. And do you know, and my wife can tell you, I don't eat ice cream every night anymore. Because I had a wake-up call. I acknowledge that this is not good for me. That's what you have to do. You have to acknowledge that disagreement is destructive. Disagreement is not good for you. Can we just acknowledge that together? Come on, let's say that together. Disagreement is destructive. Yes, yes, we all got to get to that point. Disagreement is destructive. Now, James chapter 3, verse 13 says this. James chapter 3, verse 13 says this in the New Living Translation. It says, if you are wise and understand God's ways, prove it by living an honorable life, doing good works with the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you are bitterly jealous and there is selfish ambition in your heart, don't cover up the truth with boasting and lying. For jealousy and selfishness are not God's kind of wisdom. Can I say that again? Jealousy and selfishness are not God's kind of wisdom. Such things are earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. Verse 16. For wherever there is jealousy and selfish ambition, there, everybody say there. Okay, now we're describing another place. Now remember, we said that agreement has a place, right?
Right.
Well, disagreement has a place.
Okay.
Just like agreement has a place, disagreement has a place.
All right?
And so it says there in that place of disagreement. Can you say disagreement?
Disagreement.
There in that place of disagreement, you will find, it says there, you will find disorder and evil of every kind.
Wow.
Yeah. Over here in agreement, you got peace.
Yeah.
You got love.
Yeah.
You got anointing.
Yeah.
You're empowered to do something that you couldn't do by yourself.
Right.
Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
Over here, you got all this good stuff. But over here in disagreement, in this place, you got nothing but destruction, chaos, disorder.
Wow.
Oh my God. And look, every sort of evil thing is over here in disagreement. Now, I ask you, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure out what place you want to seek after.
Amen. Yeah.
I want to seek after the place of agreement,
right,
not disagreement.
Yeah.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yeah.
All right, so envy and selfishness or pride. Can everyone say that word with me? Pride.
Pride.
Pride produces confusion and every it opens the door to destruction.
Wow.
Now, in verse 13, it talks about humility or meekness, the meekness of wisdom. See, God's wisdom is meek. And it's talking about the wisdom from above. There's a wisdom from below.
Sure is.
There is a wisdom from below. But there's a wisdom from above. And it says the wisdom from above is first pure. It says it's pure. That means that there are no hidden motives in godly wisdom. Whenever you walk in godly wisdom or humility, because humility is a part of godly wisdom. Whenever you walk in humility, there are no selfish motives. There are no prideful motives. You're not just out about your agenda to get your agenda accomplished. You're about the right thing.
Amen.
Let's get the right thing accomplished, whether or not I'm good with it or not.
That's right.
I'm about the right thing. Can you say that with me? I'm about the right thing.
Right.
See, you guys, we got to be good about the right thing. The word of God is the right thing.
Amen.
My wife and I, we base everything in our marriage, every decision we make, based on the truth, based on the Word of God. And this is the right thing. So listen, there are some times when I get in my selfish ways. There may be some times when she get in her ways. And you know what? We have to humble ourselves, and we have to and we have to say, now, no, what's the right thing? Oh, can somebody get with me? What's the right thing? And I believe that we can all do that, man. We can get past our differences. We can get past our disagreement. You have to put your hands together and clap for them. What's the right thing? Wisdom is humble. Wisdom is peaceable. It's willing to yield. It's merciful. My God, Lord, listen, you can't do that in your flesh.
Okay.
When somebody has made you mad and you're going to humble, man, my goodness. Listen, you know what humbling yourself looks like?
Come on.
Yeah. This is what humbling yourself looks like. Now, you know what? It wasn't easy to do that. It took a conscious effort, watch this, to do this.
Amen.
It took a conscious effort to do that.
Yeah.
It takes a conscious effort to humble yourself.
Right.
You don't just humble yourself by saying, I'm going to be humble today.
Come on.
No. It takes a conscious effort to humble yourself, not to walk in pride, because it's a part of your human nature to want to get your way, to want to get puffed up,
come on,
prideful. No, I want my way. I'm gonna win this argument. I'm gonna have the last word. I'm not gonna let you have the last word. See, I'm not gonna let you show me up.
Come on.
No, but humbling says I'm not concerned about getting my way. I'm concerned about God's way.
Amen.
So I'm gonna humble myself in this situation. And I'm gonna hush my mouth. I'm gonna shut up just for a little while, long enough, so I can get some understanding.
Woo! Say that.
So I can get some wisdom. Go ahead and put your hands together. Y'all need that one to clap. It's hard. I know it's hard. Pride produces confusion and destruction. Sweetheart, take us to talk about this coming around the table.
So we're going to talk about getting to agreement, all right? How to get to agreement when you don't disagree. There will be plenty of times in your relationships and all kinds of situations and circumstances when there's a direction that needs to be decided, there's something that needs to be done, and you don't agree, all right? How do you get to the agreement? So the first thing I want to talk to you about is we are around this table on purpose. Because you've got to first come together, right?
Yes.
You've got to come together. And we're at this table because I want this to impact your homes. You know, I want this to impact all of your relationships. I want you to see when you know that you've got an issue, a situation, a circumstance, that you need to come to agreement on, but you don't agree. Come to a place.
Come to a table.
Come on now.
Come to a place.
It might be a physical table.
First thing you've got to do, yes, that's what I'm talking about. Come to a place, a table. And is this table is to come to agreement around this table. Powerful things happen around a table.
Mm. Say that.
If you look at a table scripturally, the table always represents people coming together for communion,
to relate.
Yes.
See, you'll see the bottom line of this is about love.
Yeah.
It's about love. It's not your way, his way, or her way, or whatever way. It's really about love.
That's right.
A table of agreement. Come to a place. A table of agreement. And the point of coming to that table is to work toward an agreement.
Yes.
Work toward agreement. To get there, the first thing both parties have to do is humble themselves. Number one, if you're taking notes, humble yourself. We talked about pride produces confusion and destruction. So you got to put pride down. You got to humble yourself. You got to humble yourself. Pride is basically the seed of the self. It's from the self life. Wow. And it's for your destruction. Bible says pride comes before destruction. So you got to put pride away. That means you got to put selfishness away. You got to put just your agenda away, and you've got to now be ready to take on the perspective and try to understand another, both parties. Number one, what do you have to do?
Humble yourself.
You gotta humble yourself. You're never gonna get to an agreement with both people in pride. You'll never get there.
That's good.
You got to humble yourself. Number two, open your heart. Number two, you must open your heart. That means you have to open your mind to gain another person's perspective.
Wow.
Open your mind to gain another person's perspective.
That's good.
Third thing you've got to do, open your ears.
Mm.
Open your ears. It's called active listening. Mm. It's not hearing, uh-huh. but listening.
Listening.
There's
say
a difference.
That. Say that.
Listening is totally different. Listening always involves understanding.
Wow.
You could be hearing something. I live in a house with six kids. Most of the time, two are away in college, but six girls. And y'all know what girls do. Boys, they say, well, having boys in the house, you hear stuff breaking all the time because boys are, they're real boisterous or whatever. But in girls, the difference is girls talk all the time.
Yeah.
It's constant, it's constant.
Screaming.
Yeah! So we live in a house full of noise all the time. I hear it, but I'm not listening to it.
That's
I can't, if I can't listen to it, it's too much to listen to. I hear it going on all the time. I hear it all the time, but I'm not listening to it.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So when you hearing and listening are totally different.
Yeah.
So when you open your ears, you come around the table of agreement, you've got to listen.
Yes.
Listen. You've got to listen. Listen for understanding. Seek to understand when you're listening. Listen to respond in a way that is going to move the relationship forward.
That's good.
Not respond in a way that's going to
stifle it.
Yeah,
right.
It's going to move the relationship forward. This is if you want to get to agreement. We just showed you what happens when you get to agreement. It's got to be worth it for you. It's got to be worth it for both parties.
That's right.
And it is when you get there. Number four, you got to open up your mouth. We said you got to open up your heart, got to open up your ears, but you also have to open up your mouth. That means that you got to be willing to share your perspective, your needs, your desires, what you see. Everybody see that?
Notice what came before opening your mouth.
What's that? Your ears.
Open your ears. Yes. And we on purpose said open your ears before you open your mouth. Open your ears. I think you should do that in your prayer life with God.
Yeah.
In your devotional time with God. Sometimes we go to God and we just want God to understand our needs. But when we go to God, a true relationship
wow.
is about going into that meeting place.
Yeah.
That desired and predetermined meeting place, your prayer closet or wherever that is. To seek to understand the other person's needs.
Amen.
And so the only way you can do that is you must first open your ears.
Yeah.
Then open your mouth.
Wow.
Yes. That's why I read my Bible before I start praying.
That's true.
Because God speaks to me through His Word.
Right. Wow.
And once God speaks to me through His Word, then I open my mouth.
Wow. Right.
And I begin praying because I don't want to pray what I think.
That's wise.
I want to pray His Word.
Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Wow.
All right. Some keys here. Some keys to getting to agreement are, number one, humility. The whole point, my husband and I, we teach a lesson. I think we may have it out there. It's called Relationship Deal Breakers and Game Changers.
Yeah, that's right.
Relationship Deal Breakers and Game Changers. But the game changer, we actually found out there are three potential relationship deal breakers. But there's one game changer that can shift every relationship.
Everything. That's right.
And it's called humility.
Humility. Wow. It's the game changer.
It is the game changer.
Amen.
In every relationship is humility. When both parties put the self-life down, put pride down, and my way or the highway down, put down throwing their weight around, who's on top, who's on bottom, put all that down, put it down. Relationships are partnerships. Equal ground. Put that down. Everything can change. It is a game changer.
You know, you and I, we were discussing humility the other day, and it really it was a thought that just flooded my head, was that humility can really make you look inferior.
Yeah.
It can make you look weak.
And
that's hard for men to look weak. I'm just gonna go ahead and tell you because I'm a man. Men don't like to look weak. And so that's why sometimes we can look like knuckleheads in a relationship. Because it's real hard for us to bag down first.
Sure is.
Wow. Because
it seems like a sign of weakness. But it's not a sign. Humility is actually a sign of strength. It really is speaking to who is the bigger person.
Wow. Ooh, that's good.
It speaks to who is the bigger person. I'm just helping my brothers out of the room.
Come on, man.
Help. Oh my goodness. So number one is humility.
And you know, humility, you guys, it takes Christ working in you to be humble. It's the nature of Christ.
Yes.
Flesh can't produce humility. I'm telling you right now. Flesh cannot do it. Flesh cannot do it. It is the Spirit of Christ working in you. The essence of Christ is humility.
It is humility.
His power was his humility. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad that he could have called 10,000 angels to get him off of that cross?
But he humbled himself, even to the point of death.
Aren't you glad he humbled himself?
Yes, sir.
He told Pilate, he said, "You can't take my life."
I lay it down.
He said, "I lay it down."
Wow.
He knew who he was, but he withheld it. To produce something greater for us. Humility is a powerful thing.
Babe, I know we gotta move on. We're running out of time, but would you stand up? Now we have come to the place, right? We said that agreement is a place, so we have come to a place. We've agreed upon a place, and we've agreed upon, I believe, before you can agree upon a direction, I believe we have to take the seat. That's why we got these seats here.
Oh, humility.
We have to take the seat of humility.
Wow, that's good.
What you mean, Pastor? I've come to the place.
Come to the table. I ain't got in the seat.
You said come to the table.
I'm at the table.
I'm at the table.
That's right.
Now what I got to do?
Take the seat.
You got to take the seat.
All right.
You got to take the seat of humility.
Wow.
Because when you take a seat, what it does is it disarms people.
Ooh, wow, that's good.
That's why you can rarely eat a meal with somebody. I'm just letting you in on my secrets, on my leadership secrets. You can rarely, this is how you diffuse and de-escalate confrontation.
Come on, man.
Is have a meal with somebody.
Yeah.
Because it de-escalates the tension. To sit down with someone, you are taking a posture. When you take a seat, you are taking a posture of humility.
That's good.
When you sit down at the table with someone, you are taking a posture of humility.
Come on, man.
That's good, isn't it?
All right, that's good. So come to the table of agreement and then
stay in the seat.
Seat of humility.
Stay in the humble seat.
Humble seat. All right. Number two, second key is wisdom. Wisdom. Always remember, wisdom seeks peace, not its own way. Self wants its own way, but the wise one around the table is after peace. Always remember that. Wisdom seeks
win-win.
The peace. Wisdom seeks peace. Wisdom seeks for the win-win. The win-win.
Which brings peace.
Which brings peace. And I promise you, in every scenario, Reggie, you're an attorney. You know what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is negotiation.
Just negotiation.
It's negotiation. There's always a win-win.
That's right.
You gotta keep talking sometimes. You gotta keep yielding.
Yeah.
You gotta keep yielding. But eventually you're gonna come to where a win-win where both parties are happy.
That's right.
That's right.
Both parties, I can live with this. Both parties say, yeah, I can live with that. You can live with that. Yeah, I can live with that. I can live with that. Yeah, yeah. I'm telling you, when you get to that point, you watch and see. That's where God is.
That's where God is. That's where the blessing is.
That's where the blessing is.
Because he commands the blessing.
That's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
That's the right direction. Not what he wanted, not what I wanted, But the win-win that we worked out at the table of agreement, I promise you, is where God is.
Good.
Yes, yes.
That's the right thing to do.
That's right.
Right there. That's the right way to go. That's the right thing to do. We've had this scenario. We've had this scenario. It concerned our daughter. And I'll never forget this moment. When we first moved to Charlotte, our daughter went to a certain college in North Carolina. I won't name the school. But her was her freshman year, and she was kind of turning her own corner. Socially, if y'all know what I mean. And a few things happened, and I could tell my husband was staying up at night. I could tell it really was bothering him. It was bothering me as well, but as a dad and a protector, it was really bothering him. You know, this was our first child going off to college. So one thing happened, and we knew we had to make a decision. And it was almost as if the same moment, I remember the moment where we looked at each other at the same time and said, she coming home.
She got to come home.
We were in just perfect agreement. And when I tell you, it worked out beautifully. When I tell you it was the right thing to do, because it worked out beautifully.
That's where God
there was no confusion. She even, when we came and talked to her about it, she even agreed. Yeah, I think I need to
She was relieved.
She was Amen. Relieved.
Yeah.
She was relieved. Everything worked out, and she is now at her dream school.
Amen.
The school she always wanted to go to.
Amen.
There was no confusion. There was no doubt. There was no struggle.
Right.
I mean, God was there.
Yeah.
It was God. It was the right thing
That's
to
right.
do.
Yeah. That's right.
You know, when we came to that. So that's powerful. The third key is love. It's love. We said humility, wisdom, and then love.
Amen.
Getting to agreement is really all about love.
It's all about love.
It's all about love. It's all about being concerned about another.
Yes.
People coming together and talking and relating and sharing their heart and their desires and the way they see it and their perspectives. And you keep talking, and you'll get to that win-win. Really, it's all about love. Love keeps searching until it finds the place where you agree.
That's good.
Self just give up.
Say it again.
But love keeps searching. Yeah.
Love keeps searching.
Until it finds the place.
Come on.
Where you agree.
You agree. Mm. It keeps searching until it finds the
love
place.
Love doesn't give up.
Love doesn't give up. Remember the 1 Corinthians 13 says, love doesn't give up. Love is a strategy
love
that never fails.
Always.
It always wins. It always wins.
Yeah.
So love equals finding agreement when you don't agree. Love will lead you to find an agreement. Even when you disagree, love keeps searching until it finds the place where you agree. When you find that agreement, build there.
Build there.
Build there. Stay there. Focus there. Because that's where God is. And that's where powerful things happen. That's where God is.
I want to, before I talk about irreconcilable differences and we're done, and I just want to stand just as a monumental sign of unity and agreement, that when my wife and I, when we take this posture, this is a posture of power. This is a posture that we are getting ready to get any and everything done that God has said we can get done. This is a posture of power. This is a posture of empowerment. We are together. Okay. When I was struggling over the decision to leave Arkansas and come to Charlotte, my wife told me, she said, one of the most powerful things a man can ever hear from a woman is she says, I'm with you.
Wow. Yeah. All right.
Men, will y'all not get behind me?
Right.
I say that's one of the most powerful things you can hear from a woman. Yeah. I'm with you. I got your back.
Yeah.
If you go there and fail, we failed together.
Yeah.
I back you 100%. If you're frustrated with people that you're in relationships with, they need to know that you back them.
That's right.
And maybe they'll move forward a little bit. Maybe they'll make some progress.
Yeah.
Whereas now they might be a little stuck.
Yeah.
But I say that to say that me and my wife, we have this ritual that we go through when we're in crisis mode. Everybody experiences crisis in their life at certain times of their life. we don't stay in crisis mode, but there are crises. And we have had some crises, some major crises in our life, like when our daughter was diagnosed with mono in junior high school. And they were saying that she was going to be away from basketball for a full year. They were saying that she was going to be at home in bed for months, not even able to get out of bed. And we looked at each other and we said, oh, no, we don't receive that.
Amen.
We said, oh, no. And so our ritual is that we come to a place of agreement. We come to a table. And the Bible talks about a specific table. It calls it the Lord's table. And we come around the Lord's table and we take communion. We literally take communion together. We have a communion set at home. When we had found out about Danita's diagnosis, we came over to her home and we sat around the table. We sat around your table and we took communion together. We came in covenant, in agreement together. And so we do this. We take communion and we remember everything that Jesus did for us through the breaking of his body and through the shedding of his blood.
Yes.
And we have holiness through that.
Yes.
He says, as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of what I have done. And so that's what we do when we take communion. And then we begin to confess the word of God over our situation.
Yes.
That's powerful.
Yes.
We don't speak our mind. We don't speak our fears. We speak the word. And then, once we speak the word, then we begin rejoicing over what God has already done. And do you know that we did that for weeks with Alexa? We would go to her bedside. Not for weeks. It was just a few days.
It was every day.
It was every day we did that with her. We took communion.
2 weeks.
Maybe 2 weeks. And long story short, they said, we can't find a trace of money. My daughter got up and she was like, I'm ready to go back to school, Dad. I said, go back to school. What do you mean? They said, you're going to be in bed for.
No, I got to tell the story.
Yeah, tell her.
And I was there. So she went back for her 2-week appointment. She was feeling good probably after about maybe 10 days or so, like she could go back to school. But of course, you know, we didn't want her to do that because, you know, you're trying to heed the doctor's words. And so at least until she had her, I think it was like a 2-week appointment or something. So I took her back to see the doctor in 2 weeks and she was feeling great. So the guy that ran the test, the second batch of tests on her, he came in, he said, so she did have a mono diagnosis? I said, yes, sir. She was diagnosed with mono. He said, I see not one trace of mono. Hey. There's he said, I just don't see I don't see a reason why she can't return to any of her normal activities.
Yeah.
I just don't see a reason why. And this is what got me. It chokes me up every time I see it. And so, because we had been doing communion with her every morning and reading over the covenant. So when we got in the car, she said, so I don't have any mono. I said, no, ma'am. He said, you didn't you find? She said, so tell me more about this covenant. She's 2020, you know.
The same daughter.
Yeah, she's never forgotten. She's been through it so many times.
She was our basketball star.
Yes.
And she tore her Achilles in practice, her Achilles tendon. Quick story. She says, we were at the doctor's office. She says, why does this stuff keep happening to me, Daddy?
Come on, man.
I'm
laughing.
And we went into crisis mode.
Yeah.
And we came to the table. We did the exact same thing. The orthopedic surgeon that the Lord led us to, the first orthopedic surgeon said he's going to have to cut her open and he's going to have to cut an incision about this long. Long story short, God led us to the right orthopedic surgeon, one of the best in the world at this particular procedure. Matter of fact, he was certified in this, one of the few certified in this particular procedure that he performed on my daughter. And he just put a couple of holes in the back of her ankle. And they were saying that she was going to be out a year. My daughter was out 2.5, 3 months. She was back by March.
Wow.
running up and down from a torn Achilles tendon.
Yeah.
Yes. And made all conference her senior year.
Wow.
Yes, God is good. Got the highest score.
We can tell you we've come to the table so many times.
Yeah.
With all of this and moving our big major to Charlotte.
900 miles across country.
And the huge budgets and financial issues that we were facing on a regular basis, governing our church back in Arkansas, our mega family, and then getting this established. And every crisis moment when it looks like things weren't going to add up, people weren't adding up, money wasn't adding up, nothing was adding up, we would do what we always do. We come to the table. This is a table of agreement. And when you come to the table of agreement, sometimes you're coming to get an agreement with each other. Sometimes you're coming to get an agreement with the Word of God.
Amen.
Yes.
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 But it's agreement. It's a powerful thing. Mm. We're going to deal with every need met. And so the table of agreement is powerful. What we want you to see.
You know, I know God is in here, but I feel God in a very tangible way right now. I don't know if you sense what I sense, but there's the presence of God is here in an extraordinary way right now.
Yeah.
I want to ask you if you will just do me this favor, come to the altar. All of you, you and your family.
Yeah.
See, when we come to the altar, it signifies us coming to a place of agreement. Yes. Do you know one of the greatest terms that's used to justify divorce in this world today? You know what that is, Alton? Irreconcilable differences. It's the most commonly used term on a divorce document. Irreconcilable differences. Do you know all irreconcilable differences mean? Not just in that framework of a divorce. You know all that means? Is that we disagree on some things. That's all it means. Y'all, that's all it means, Alton. We disagree on some things. People get divorced because they disagree on some things. One of both parties gave up on real love. What does real love look like? Yielding, humbling themselves, and finding a place where they do agree so that they can build a life there. You can agree.
Amen.
When you disagree. You can get to agreement. Say that with me. Make that your confession. I can get to agreement. I can get to agreement. Father God, I pray over each and every one of these dear people before us today. I pray, Father, for them and their relationships. The enemy is attacking relationships. And I come against every spirit of division, disunity, disagreement. Yes.
Push back that pride.
Now. Yeah, we push back pridefulness.
I say pride will have no place in you.
We loose humility in the hearts of your people now in Jesus' name. In every relationship.
Yes.
Where there's supposedly irreconcilable differences. Just simply things that we disagree upon.
Thank you, Jesus.
I pray, Father, that there will be a yielding now. There will be a humbling now. And there will be a focusing and disciplining of ourselves to find a place to agree upon. That we can build a life there together. I pray this for churches, Father, where there are disagreements and people just don't see the eye to eye on various things. Church members and parishioners and pastors and Father, I pray that in families and husbands and wives and parents and their children and Father, siblings, sisters and brothers and mothers and fathers and mothers and sons and fathers and sons and fathers and daughters. I pray it on their jobs, Father, in their workplace, Father. Peace. And I pray a peace of God that surpasseth all understanding.
Yes.
That will keep and guard our hearts in Christ Jesus.
Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Now, Father, I pray for each and every one under the sound of my voice. I want you to bow your heads if they're not already. I want you to close your eyes. This is a sacred moment. This is a sacred time. And if you're here and you need to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to invite you to do so. I want to invite you to receive Jesus Christ, to confess Him. What does that look like? That means that I confess Him as I say, Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the Lord of my life. He's my Savior. I confess that. And I believe with all of my heart that God the Father raised Him from the dead. The Bible says if you confess that and if you believe that, you will experience salvation, eternal life. So that's what it looks like to receive Jesus. If you need to receive Jesus Christ today, you have not yet confessed Him as your Lord and believed in your heart, I want you to make that decision to do that today. It will be the best decision you ever made in your life. And then next thing is you need to return back to God. You backslid. You moved far away. Your relationship with God is broken. It's not good. But the Father is waiting with open arms, loving arms, not to condemn you, not to judge you, but to call you back to the place of agreement with the Father. And you won't get a finger pointed at you saying you should never did this and did that. No, the Father just, He wants you to come back to that place of love and agreement. So if you want to return today, Pastor, yes, I already know Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, but I need to rededicate. I need to recommit my life back to Him. I need to return today. And the third thing is I need to connect. Pastor, I need a place where I can come together with other believers to agree. I want to connect with the Restoration Place today. As a member, I want to connect with this spiritual family of believers. So you need to receive, or you need to return, or you need to connect. I want to pray for those three things today. I also want to pray for special prayer requests. If you have any special prayer requests, any one of those four categories that I have just spoken, and you fit in one of those categories to receive, to return, to connect, or you just have special prayer you want someone to agree with you upon, I want you to slip your hand up so I can acknowledge you. I want to know who am I praying for today. Just slip that hand up. Nobody's looking except me and God. Slip that hand. Yes, I see your hand, sir. I see your hand down front. Anybody else, slip that hand up high so I can see you. Slip it up so I can see you. Yes. Say this with me. Father God, forgive me of my sin. Today, I confess that Jesus is Lord. He is the Son of God. I believe with all of my heart. You raised Jesus from the grave. That my sin might be forgiven. That I might have eternal life. Jesus, thank you for coming into my heart. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. Be my friend. I turn away from my old life. And I turn to you. To my new life. In Christ. Today. Thank you for saving me. Now, Father, I pray for all of those that have been far away and they're returning today. They made a decision to return. Come back to God. Come back to the Father. Back into your loving arms. Receive Him. I declare that they will not feel any condemnation or judgment, but they'll feel nothing but love. Father, for those families that they want to connect with the Restoration Place today, I pray that you will strengthen them to make that decision to connect. To find the spiritual family that can come into agreement with them. It's a place of empowerment. And Father, for all of those special prayer requests that are in the hearts of the people, some of them weren't even verbalized. I don't know what they are, but you do. And now I pray that you would minister, Father, with specificity to each and every one of those prayer requests in our hearts today. Answer them now. We thank you. We rejoice over answered prayer. In Jesus' name.
Thank you for listening to this inspired message. The mission of Howard International Ministries is to help you discover your identity in Christ so you can live your highest life. Visit us at our website at wearefor him.org. That's weare4him.org, where you can submit your prayer request, watch and listen to more inspiring messages, purchase our books and teaching, and download any of our free discovery resources. There you can also inquire about the Howard's availability for your conference or event. Thank you for listening, and God bless.